Hello all, this is Dr. Alsop again, and I'm very excited to get to talk about the meninges and some of the specializations of the dura mater, specifically the dural partitions. So we have quite a bit to go through, so let's get started. So as we know from the lecture videos, meninges are those membranous coverings of the brain and the spinal cord. There are three types of meninges, and the most external layer is the dura mater, which is the toughest and the thickest layer. So it's often looking this kind of pearly white color or silver color. Now, when the calvaria or the skull cap is removed, the first thing that you should see is not the brain, but the dura mater, which you can see very clearly here. So we are looking directly at dura when we're looking at this image. You can see a bit of the dural venous sinus that's going to be deep to this region. And we're going to talk a little bit more about the dural venous sinuses in another video. But the rest of what you can see here is the dura mater. And you can see in this particular image over here that the dura is, when it's reflected superiorly, you can really see how thick and opaque the dura is. And it will be pretty distinguishable from the thinner and more translucent arytenoid and pia maters. The dura mater associated with the brain is different from the dura mater of the spinal cord that we've already talked about, as it has two separate layers. The layer that you can see when you're looking at the superior view without the dura being opened is the periosteal, which we have here. Sometimes you hear it referred to as the endosteal layer. The meningeal layer is typically very closely adhered to both the periosteal dura and the arytenoid mater, but in certain areas there are elongations of the meningeal layer of the dura mater that help to protect the brain and create compartments in the cranial cavity, and these are the dural partitions. Also in certain areas, the meningeal dura will kind of reflect away from the periosteal dura to allow for the dural venous sinuses to flow. So you can see right about here, so closely adhered to the bone would be the periosteal dura, and then you can see a reflection occurring right about here. This part of the dura is going to be the meningeal, and you can see it's heading this way and reflecting off, so that's going to be a partition. And you can see this dark area right here is where a dural venous sinus would flow. So you can see how it's nicely reflecting off, and anything that is reflecting off will be part of that meningeal dura. Now moving to the deeper meninges, let's try to understand where the arytenoid and pia mater are going to be located. The arytenoid is a little thicker and can actually be dissected away from the brain, so this is going to be part of the arytenoid right here, whereas the pia mater is so closely adhered to the brain, it cannot easily be dissected away. So the pia is what's really giving the brain and the spinal cord that shiny appearance. So the pia mater would be directly on the brain. Now, looking at the spinal cord, which I know isn't in this particular session, but I want to review a few things really quickly. Sometimes it's easier to see these deeper meninges. Now, the pia mater, again, is very closely adhered to the spinal cord. You can see it how it's really making the spinal cord look shiny here. What the forceps are holding on to is the dura mater, with the arytenoid mater very closely adhered to the dura. You can see a little bit of it kind of right around this region. Now, what is really nicely visible in this image are the arytenoid trabeculae. You can see these kind of all over the place here. It is these arytenoid trabeculae that give the spider web-like appearance associated with the arytenoid, and thus why the arytenoid mater has its name. The trabeculae are located within the subarytenoid space that separates the arytenoid and the pia mater, which also has vessels and CSF, or cerebrospinal fluid, during life. All right, let's move back to the discussion of the dural partitions and stop for a second and try to think of what these partitions are composed of. So we reviewed it towards the beginning, but think about, what are dural partitions made of? I bet you got it right. It's going to be that meningeal dura. Perfect. Okay, so let's get into those four dural partitions, and we'll try to look at them in some different views. Here we are looking at a superior lateral view with only half of the calvaria removed, so you can see the other half is over here, and obviously the brain's been removed. We can see two of the four dural partitions pretty well here. And we'll start with the falx cerebri. This is the largest of the dural partitions and is very distinctly sickle-shaped. And when the brain is present, it's going to run right down the middle of the longitudinal fissure between the cerebral hemispheres. The partition is going to attach to the crista galli of the ethmoid bone all the way back towards the internal occipital protuberance of the occipital bone. So obviously my squiggly line isn't exactly as nice and anatomical as I would like it, but I want you to understand that it has a fairly large expanse from the most anterior portions of the skull back to some of the most posterior portions of the skull. It will also house both the superior, which you can see here, and you can't see as well, but the inferior sagittal sinuses. And we'll have a video specific to the venous sinuses in another session. You can also see in this image the Tentorium Cerebelli. So you can see a little bit of it here. You can see a bit of it over here. This is the second largest dural partition. It's going to sit a bit more transversely, separating the cerebrum, specifically the occipital lobes, from the cerebellum. So in essence, the forebrain is going to sit above the Tentorium Cerebelli, and the hindbrain will be inferior. Now we are looking at a straight superior view here. Also importantly, the falx cerebri has been removed. But now we have a really nice view of the Tentorium Cerebelli and how expansive it is. So here is the Tentorium Cerebelli on either side. You can see a bit where that falx cerebri did sit. So you can see a little bit of a remnant of it here. Now, one thing I want you to note is you can see this distinct curved notch associated with the Tentorium Cerebelli. Excuse me. And this is the tentorial notch. This notch is where the midbrain sits during life. And it also separates the Tentorium Cerebelli from the diaphragmatic cellae, which you can see a little bit of in this region here. All right, so what is the diaphragmatic cellae? It's going to cover the cella turcica of the sphenoid bone and forms a roof over the hypophyseal fossa. So it will have during life an aperture for the infundibulum or the pituitary stalk, because we know that the posterior pituitary is going to be in this region here. Now, this partition is the smallest and the least dense, so a good amount of it has been removed in this dissection, but as long as you get an understanding of where the diaphragmatic cellae would be located, conceptually we were happy with that, because often in dissections it's not very visible. Now, last but not least, we're going to have the falx cerebelli. So not the falx cerebri, the falx cerebelli. So we know it probably has something to do with the cerebellum, or have a close relationship there. And you can see just a little bit of it right about here. So the falx cerebri would have stopped a little bit more superiorly. We are looking at a superior view again, but not only has the falx cerebri been removed, but also the Tentorium Cerebelli, and that's an important distinction. The Tentorium Cerebelli has to be removed or reflected in order to see any of the falx cerebelli. The falx cerebelli is located between the cerebellar hemispheres when the brain is present. And when the brain is not present, you can see it inferior to where the Tentorium Cerebelli would be located, and heading kind of towards, but not quite to, the foramen magnum. All right, so that is our review of the cranial meninges as well as the dural partitions. As always, after you've reviewed these, and if you have any outstanding questions, please make sure that you reach out to me, and have a wonderful day.